Welcome to the Popish Pot. I'm Nate.
I'm Jessica.
And I'm Mike.
And today we are here with another installment of our Hispanic Heritage Month saints. Today's saint...
Every one of these saints has been amazing.
Haven't they?
Like, and I had to, like, go through multiple ones and be like, oh, that one has too much information, that one doesn't have enough,
no.
You know, to get... Or, you...
No, we're basically just picking names out of a hat, and they're all solid gold.
Yeah. I'm just saying, you know, I had tons that I could do, but I'm like... I have to limit it down, and I can't do one where I'm like, I'm going to spend an hour talking about this person.
So, who do we have today?
Today, we have Saint Laura Montoya. They killed her father. Prepared to be treated equally.
Well, I literally, she was on the list of saints of Latin America, and I'm like, her name is very close to the Princess Bride guy. If they killed her father.
Sure. See?
Like,
I understand.
Sentence two in her life. And her father died when she was two. I'm like, all right, we're doing it.
but the big difference is that if...
And then I found out she was, of course, a wonderful, amazing person that we should all look up to. But
whatever hook you need.
The difference is that had a six-fingered man killed her father in an attempt to get out of paying a bill... Her response likely would have been, well, may God have mercy on his soul.
Mm-hmm. If a six-fingered Christopher Guest kills your father.
Well, it's Christopher Guest. I'm just going to do what needs to be done.
Anyway.
So back to St. Laura.
Can someone please say her birth name for us? Because like many names in this thing, it's much longer than what we wrote down first.
I can say that one. Okay, there's
María Laura de Jesús Montoya Upegui.
And then her religious name, as she became a religious sister, is Laura of St. Catherine of Siena.
Everybody loves St. Catherine of Siena.
She's a very popular
Everybody wants to
they
be St. Catherine.
They call
Catherine.
Her Mama. And she yelled at popes. What's not to love?
I like the fact that essentially it was like a Catherine club, because there was multiple St. Catherines that all got together for that one. It's like, this is a cat club. You can't join unless you yell at the Pope for being in France.
She was born May 26, 1874. In Jericho, Colombia. She died October 21st, 1949. Ooh. So she lived to the ripe old age of 75. In Medellin, Colombia. And she was beatified April 25th, 2004. And canonized May 12th, 2013.
Mm-hmm. She's the patron of people suffering from racial discrimination, orphans, the Congregation of Missionary Sisters of the Immaculate Mary and St. Catherine of Siena.
Nice. She's the first saint of Colombia, and she's a popular role model for girls in South America.
Mm-hmm. Probably for reasons besides that Princess Bride was a wonderful film, even if it was a kissing one. She was the middle of three children. Her father died in...
Three? That's shockingly contemporary.
Well, her father died in the Colombian Civil War when she was about two.
There you go. There would have been more.
At which point her family's goods were confiscated because of his fighting in the war, and they became very poor.
Oh.
So she was sent to live with her grandmother at first.
Okay.
Which caused her to feel rather abandoned by the family.
Sure.
Because, you know, her grandmother, as far as I can tell, didn't mistreat her or anything, but mm-hmm. she wasn't a exactly warm and loving woman mm-hmm. for her mm-hmm. child.
Yeah.
And then she ended up living in an orphanage, which happened to be run by an aunt. So it's not like they sent her to an orphanage. They sent her to her aunt's.
Who runs an orphanage.
Yeah, it's not like, okay, you stay over here and I'm going to be running my orphanage over here. No, that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
At the age of 16, she applied to be a teacher so that she could help the family, even though she had no formal education. She did very well at
teaching. She had gumption.
Yep, and she did very well at teaching school mm-hmm. and started teaching in different parts of her department.
Nice.
Yes, and in this case, in Colombia, a department is the equivalent of a state yeah. in America, from what I can tell.
Yep.
So she was sort of like a traveling, she was like a traveling substitute kind of a thing.
Mm-hmm.
School marm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She, much like many people, wanted to become a Carmelite nun of the shoeless variety.
But her name wasn't Teresa, so what could she do?
Well, they get renamed Teresa. But the issue was she felt more drawn to helping the local people of South America that, you mm-hmm. know, in various indigenous tribes of the area. Mm-hmm. And Carmelites are cloistered, so
yep.
they don't go out.
Mm-hmm.
So...
Well, she did the noble thing. She had a desire, but God was calling her to something different, so she gave up her dream to follow mm-hmm. God's dream for her.
Yes, mm-hmm. and much like how St. Patrick went and took everything that was good from the Irish culture
yep.
to share about Christ from that.
Yep.
She wanted to join the various local tribes' culture to Christianity and said that she wanted to become an Indian with the Indians to win them all for Christ.
Nice.
Little note. We're using the term she used in this because that's what they were used at that time for the local peoples.
Yeah. In 1908, she founded the Works of the Indians when working with the natives of the Uraba and Sarare regions. She wanted to eliminate the racial discrimination against Native Americans and bring them Christ's love and teachings.
Nice.
Yes. Although, like, I, as someone from the United States, tend to think of, you know, Latin America being very, you know, mixed between the Spanish and the natives and everything. Apparently, at that time, there was very, very much racial discrimination against the native people.
Mm-hmm.
To the point, like, many other discriminated groups of people, they were thought to be subhuman mm-hmm. and stupid and so forth. So, well, you know, was very groundbreaking. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, a huge percentage of the population is mixed. A small percentage of the population is pure native. And then there's generally an upper class that is essentially purely European descended.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So, on May 14, 1914... her and four other women started a new order called the Missionaries of Mary Immaculate and St. Catherine of Siena.
You gotta get Catherine in there.
Hence her name and the fact that she is the patron of this order.
Yep.
And there was the Bishop of Santa Fe was essentially their sponsor in helping them.
Mm-hmm.
And they set out to live with the various groups of native people in the area, traveling in the jungle by mule, but nothing about sombreros or ponchos or smoking. So,
well, again, the sombrero is to protect your head from the sun when you're on the plains of upper Argentina, not in the jungle of Colombia.
Yeah. Yes, and this was largely criticized by other, even Christian groups at the time. She knew about the criticism, and she just did not care.
Yeah,
she had a saint's disposition about it.
Yep. I'm doing important work. The fact that you're haters are going
to
hate.
Haters going to hate. You guys are trying to keep the Holy Spirit locked up in your institutions. The Holy Spirit goes where he will, and he wills to go to these people.
Now, she wrote many things for her daughters, in quotes. Yep. Not biological daughters, but women who would...
Yeah.
Part of her order, other, you know, religious sisters doing stuff.
About the call to serve God among the Indians, living a balanced life, both apostolic and contemplative, an autobiography, and that only teaching with the pedagogy of love that included loving the person and culture would work in sharing Christianity with the native peoples.
Our Lady of Guadalupe. You don't try to annihilate the native culture. You baptize every good part of it.
Yep.
Yes, because you can't insist that everything that someone did when they were pagan is wrong, because otherwise... pretty much everything's wrong.
Yep. It's a lesson that Christians have to learn over and over again, not just each generation, but each of us individually.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, for example, if you lived a particularly heathen life before you met Christ, it doesn't mean that every part of that life was wrong. You need to keep what was good and turn it towards his glory.
And take the other stuff and...
yeah.
I mean, and quite often, you know...
put it out to the road.
Reflecting it, even the bad stuff was... a very poor attempt at reaching the good.
Mm-hmm. And without the bad stuff, you never would have gotten to the good.
Mm-hmm.
So be grateful for it all.
Mm-hmm.
Back to St. Laura.
So towards the last few years of her life, she had a really long suffering illness, which found her in a wheelchair about the last decade.
This is one of the consequences of our generally improved medical care, the fact that people live longer and often in ages past when they would have died, you know, they still linger for a while.
Yes.
Yes. I mean, she is fairly modern and lived to be in her 70s.
Yep.
So given that she spent a lot of time out in more rural areas where she couldn't easily get medical aid, it's a fairly long life. And, you know, and I assume... although they didn't officially say in any of the bios, that those 9 years were where she did a lot of her writings to continue on her work.
Mm-hmm.
And her work actually continues now in 21 different countries of the Americas, Africa, and Europe, because her order has spread throughout all those areas, taking her main ideas of how to go and help the various people of the world go and integrate their culture with the love of Christ. And
to meet people where they are, to baptize the good in their world, and to help them seek the higher good.
I'm digging it.
Of Christ.
Nice. Saint Laura Montoya. A saint I did not know before we started to do this episode. So I've made a new friend in heaven.
Seriously, right? I just learned about her the other day. So this is fantastic. Saint Laura Montoya, pray for us. So go down below, and as always, leave us a comment. Maybe something in this episode really spoke to you. Maybe you have a saint of Hispanic origin that you would like to share with us, or you might like us to share with the world. While you're down there, make sure you hit the like button, the subscribe, and the bell next to it so you get notified when new episodes come out.
And until next time, remember to
live your faith.
Love your faith.
Share that love.
Or, you know, if they can't think of anything else, they could just do Princess Bride quotes. That would be cool.
That would be great comments.
Inconceivable.
I don't think that word means what you think it means.